next week, when John's officially in his new place, we're going to have that intro done live on his piano. Hey, John, how you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm going to have to improvise a new intro and outro if we're going to do it live. I can't wait to do that.
I cannot wait.
We're moving the flag to a new place that is set up as a studio for music and for live streaming and for conversational jams and everything else. So watch out.
Watch out. All right. Well, on that note, speaking of conversational jams, that is what Intersections is all about. It's a weekly conversational jam where we dive deep into the intersections of technology, innovation, culture, ideas. We feature some of our great friends who also happen to be transforming the world in their own way. I'd like to introduce my co-host, John Kao. John is, he was called Mr. Creativity by The Economist. He's a thought leader. He's an entrepreneur. He's an advisor. He's a Tony-nominated producer. He's the author of best-selling Jamming, The Art and Discipline of Business Creativity. He's taught at Harvard Business School and MIT Media Lab in Stanford. And he also chairs the Institute for Large-Scale Innovation. John, welcome.
Thanks, Brian. And I get to introduce you, which is one of the high points of my week. I can't imagine someone with whom I could jam in a more comprehensive and enjoyable way. So Brian Solis, my erstwhile co-host, has had a long and distinguished career stitching technology and marketing communications together since that stitching was possible. And he is a speaker, a thought leader, a best-selling author, has written many books, and perhaps most significantly has hyphenated his expertise in many interesting ways. The one that intrigues me the most is digital anthropologist. So Brian, here we are.
Here we are. Thank you for that kind introduction. And I also want to mention that John and I are on the social medias, so please follow us along the way. And John also has a really exciting column at Forbes. And we're going to be diversifying the Intersections brand into other media platforms, so stay tuned. So up first, we got to jump in here because we have a good friend of actually both of us who is a noted futurist, a keynote speaker, an author, and just a good all-around human being. Please welcome Gerd Linhard. And Gerd, when you're here, first, we just want to see you, your beautiful tan, your beautiful background, this incredible production setup that you have going on. Welcome to the show, Gerd. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you. Thank you.
All right. So for those who haven't yet heard of Gerd, which I find it hard to believe, I'm going to give you his official bio because I worked on this before the show and I am going to use it. So Gerd looks beyond conventional futurism. He is a futurist, and I'm sure we will get to that. I have been accused of being a futurist myself, and it is not what you think it is sometimes. He pursues practical wisdom. He foregoes, I love this, he forgoes techno-optimism in favor of progressive humanism. He zeroes in on what the future holds for humanity and how we will create the future we want. Gerd, welcome.
Thank you. That sounds impressive. I like it.
You know, actually, I have so many notes of ways and different ways I wanted to introduce you. I guess I should probably not leave out that you are ranked in the top 100 most influential people in Europe, and your latest book is Technology versus Humanity. So I guess if we bring in an old proverb or an old saying that may you live in interesting times, we might have been either blessed or cursed with that these days. But one of the key words that comes up more times than not is the word uncertainty. And while we do live in a world that is not certain, uncertainty has become quite, let's just say it's soaring to new heights these days. And so I'd love to hear how you are, as a futurist, looking at the present and considering pathways forward out of these times.
Well, I mean, it's really quite clear that the future has never been more uncertain than today. It's like every time we think of something, next week, ask me again, it will be different, right? So my job really is to pay attention, to listen, and to develop my intuition as to what may be likely scenarios. And that has become more difficult. But I think, generally speaking, if we are looking to craft the future, my approach is sort of come back from the future. not go forward to the future, right? It's called backcasting. And if you look in 10 years from now, regardless of COVID, there's still hard things that you can see there, what we call the hard futures, that are very likely to happen. You know, the end of oil, the rise of intelligent machines, the global role of renewable energy, and so on and so on. When you take that and you put it in context with COVID, then I think we can get somewhere, right? I mean, the current madness about the post-corona future is a little bit, in my view, a little bit short-sighted. So I try to go beyond that.
Well, I think a lot of people believe that a futurist should tell them what the future is going to be, right? I'm pretty sure, Gerd, you probably hear this question. Hey, where are we going to be in 10 years? But what is the question, especially right now, what is the question that we should be asking you?
Well, you know, I get this question all the time, and I think it's, of course, distorted mostly by media. But if you're looking at, you know, the big futurists, Alvin Toffler, Buckminster Fuller, and some of the older ones, you know, it's quite clear they weren't into predicting, they were observing. But for them, the future was already here, right? It's like they could touch it, and therefore they could share it. So my approach to the future is to say, well, you know, are there intuitions, imagination, hunches, you know, is there something that I could feel for certain? Like I said in 1999, music is moving to the cloud, you know, in the when I was an internet entrepreneur. And it was completely obvious. It wasn't at all futuristic, right? But it turned out to be true. You know, now we have music in the cloud. And so I'm working on those kind of hunches, intuitions. And I always say the future is not about tomorrow. The future is a mindset. And we all need a future mindset, especially today, because the present is pretty gnarly sometimes. So we have to think about what are the alternatives? You know, what kind of future do we want? And the most important question is not this one, what will the future bring? This is what everybody asks me. That question is irrelevant because the future could bring anything. Listen to Elon Musk and the Neuralace, right? The Neuralink. It could be anything. Right? The question is really, what future do we want? Right? That is, to me, the key question. And how do we build it?
John, I'm going to turn it over to you real quick. But before we do that, I just want to remind everybody who's tuning in live to please let us know where you're tuning in from. Say hello, ask your questions, and we'll make sure to feature them in the program. John, over to you.
Well, I'm curious, Gerd, given your vast experience, what distinguishes people and organizations that are able to embrace the future and embrace the mindset and the intuition that you referenced versus people who, you know, might read the book or hear the keynote, but go off and do the same old stuff. And related to that, I also wanted to add one other nuance, which is, to what extent do you look at this as a time of uncertainty and disruption versus a time of wholesale discontinuity? You know, that in a sense, we're hitting the wall in terms of our current understanding. We know there's a desired horizon, but there's a gap. So it's not just that things are uncertain and volatile, you know, and more or less volatile, but that there's an actual discontinuity that challenges us, or many discontinuities that challenge us.
Yeah, you know, F. Scott Fitzgerald once said, the sign of a strong intellect, you know, to be intelligent is to have two opposing things in your mind at the same time. And I think for a person with a future mindset, you have to function well in reality today, and then with what is, right? And then imagine what might be. And if you're looking at all the big leaders in the last 20 years in technology primarily also, right, this is what they did. This is what Steve Jobs did, right? Technology and humanity, combining the two, you know, doing well, but also imagining what is the next window. Right? So I spend a lot of time thinking about what might be rather than what is, right? And the second part of the question in regards to the pace of change and the uncertainty and all of those things, you know, this is, I think we all agree, not just the moment of depression, which is clear that if my business is down 90%, right? So I don't feel excited about that. And I think a lot of people have a similar experience, but it's also a moment of rapid invention, because when there's a crisis and you're ready to throw down the cards and say, you know what, doesn't matter anymore. I'm ready to move on because my old thing is dead. A lot of things can happen, and this is what's happening right now. United States of Europe, we're coming together in Europe. Solidarity, green energy, the green future. All these things are now suddenly becoming possible because the COVID crisis is like a giant accelerator. both good and bad, admittedly.
But in terms of organizations, let's say, what do you see as being the pattern of a future-ready organization versus a future-not-ready organization? What do they have to have in place beyond this mindset, you know, which is, you know, kind of imbibing some of the Kool-Aid and the flavor of thinking in this bimodal way? Because companies need to shift their mindset, but they also need to do other things to be future future-ready.
Well, riffing off Peter Drucker, right, I would say, culture eats technology for breakfast. So this is all about culture and personality. This is not, you can't download the capacity for the future. You can practice it, right? It's like you think about going to a therapist. You know, you go to a therapist and the therapist says, you know what, you got to split up with your wife. That's not how it works. You know, you go forward into a discussion and then you come to a conclusion. And I think what happens here with companies who are future ready is that they have the ability to allow those character skills in their executives and their teams. And that is imagination, intuition, playfulness, improvisation. That's where we both come from music, right? You improvise, right? You make up something else. And I think these are skills that companies like Apple, for example, have very much deeply ingrained in this, constantly looking for a new piece to play. Yeah. And so this is really a cultural question. I think in Europe, where I live, you know, in Switzerland here, we have this deep-seated problem that we think the future is scary and uncertain, and we don't want anything to do with it because, you know, because we prefer to keep things the same. The German Chancellor, Helmut Schmidt, once said, ex-German Chancellor 20 years ago, he says, if you have visions, you should go see a doctor.
Really?
Yeah. This is the opposite of the American attitude, which is if you don't have visions, you got to go see a doctor.
I'm curious, though. You know, in the Global Innovation Index that was just published, Switzerland ranks among the top three, I think, in terms of their innovation prowess. So I wonder if there's a bit of a disconnect there somehow.
Absolutely. I think, I live in Switzerland. I have a Swiss passport and a German passport now. And Swiss people are, Switzerland is an amazing place in so many ways, right? Mm-hmm. But imagination and cutting edge discovery and courage, and you know that's not really here. You know, it's like we make things perfect. It took Tissot, the Swiss watch brand, 7 years to come up with a competing product for the iWatch, you know, for the Apple Watch. Mm. Right? And it's going to fail. Right? It's like you look at it and say, oh, you know, come on, guys, really? You know, so I mean, there's many good things about Switzerland, but I think in terms of inventing, and inventing completely different, that is just a different place. So in Europe, we have this challenge, you know, we need to bring in the future mindset and we need to say, you know what, this is good for you to think about what is not already here, the stuff you can't prove.
You know, if I could add there, you know, I spent quite a bit of time in Geneva, and one of the things that I do when I'm there is work with the school CREA, which is really about creativity. And I meet with the students each year, and I get to see and feel what playfulness, creativity, curiosity, imagination looks like before it gets tainted in the corporate world. And I think a lot of this is not just about culture, right? Because culture itself is a reflection of design, and that design then has to come with what the German chancellor, the ex-German chancellor once said not to have, which is vision, but also all of those attributes to lead people by example and to empower them to think this way and to incentivize them to think this way. So one of the questions I have for you is, how do we ensure that we do reintroduce those skills once they've been lost into the organization so that we're not just future-proofing ourselves, but we're actually disruption-proofing how we work and how we think?
Well, it's quite clear that we have to rethink education completely, right? I think it's perfectly logical to say that everybody should know technology. So in theory, if everybody can be a programmer, that's probably a good thing. But, you know, in 10 years, computers will program themselves. I mean, that they do that now. So what is going to make us truly powerful in the future is the stuff that machines can't do. In my book, I call this the andro-rhythms, you know, rather than the algorithms. Yeah? So that is passion, imagination, negotiation, mistakes, lying, cheating, storytelling, you know. And this is what actually makes us human. I mean, this is, you know, artificial intelligence may have a lot of processing power, but, you know, in the parallel world of emotional intelligence or musical intelligence, it doesn't perform. Yeah, so I think this is really important. We go back to school and teach the humanities, right? Ethics, music, design, sports, right? And if you want to do programming, absolutely, that should be part of the mix. It's not either or, and it's also a question of talent, parentheses, right? As to what should be happening. I mean, here in Europe, we have lots of anthroposophical schools and Waldorf schools. I think there's a bunch of big ones in San Francisco as well, right? That are teaching playfulness. I think that's a very good start. And you can see many of people who are doing this, they went to art school, right? Tech leaders went to art school. Yeah, I went to Berklee College of Music, which is kind of like an art school, I guess.
Well, you know, this is one of the reasons why John and I created Intersections, was to bring these types of conversations to the forefront. Because I think, as we all know, we've all come into a workforce that has sort of frowned upon these skill sets and have molded people into groupthink, hierarchies, and basically the exact constructs that prevent us from being agile, creative, playful, and all of these things that are actually we're going to need to move forward, especially in these times. John, with the minute we have left, I'll throw it to you for one last question.
So I'm just curious, Garrett, how music has informed your thinking about the future and about the kind of work you do with companies that are trying to innovate and reach out. You know, music is a big deal for us, and I think we have a minute or so to compare some notes, literally.
Yeah, it's absolutely essential to my work. I mean, music is the humanity, right? And the skills that you learn playing music, even if you can't play, like Sex Pistols don't play, right? That sort of not elaborate level, right? You're going to create something, right? And everybody can. And I think this is something we have to go back to. It's like this playfulness and trying out stuff. And I learned a lot when I was a musician. I did learn in the end that I wasn't good enough to get, you know, to where I wanted to go for many, many reasons. But I think music is that tool that allows us to rediscover. And I think this is why it's so crucial.
You know, Yusuf Lateef, who's a famous jazz guy, once said, "All you can play is who you are." And so, you know, this idea of comparison is actually, the Buddhists would say, the source of all unhappiness. But if you're immersed in your music in the way you see it, that's the path to your authenticity. So, yeah, I agree. Music is very powerful, has lots of lessons for all of us.
What a wonderful way to close that. Gerd, such a pleasure. Please be our guest again in the future, because it's always wonderful to see your face and also to hear your voice and to hear your ideas. And also can't wait to see your next background. So thank you, Gerd, for joining us.
And welcome you back to San Francisco when travel becomes feasible.
Yeah. Let's talk about that when it becomes feasible. Thanks very much for having me, guys. See you down the road.
Ciao.
Here's Gerd.
All right. Bye.
John, I love that last question that you posed because it's a reminder that there's more to us as individuals, as thinkers, as just human beings than just what we publish, what we produce, and what we project in our daily professional lives. And on that note, I'd love to introduce our next guest, Sally Ann De La Casa. I think I'm figuring out this whole process because I now have her bio right in front of me. But before we do that, Sally Ann was introduced to us by a dear friend, Phil Cromarty. And Phil has actually been a friend to John and I for mm-hmm. many years. He's also a friend of the show. He's a pseudo advisor, unofficial advisor to the show's production. Yeah. And that's how we met Sally Ann. I'm going to go ahead and introduce Sally Ann and then officially welcome her to the show.
Hello,
Sally Ann,
how are you?
How are you?
I can't hear you.
Oh, well, gregarious. Maybe we should work on that behind the scenes. John, you can hear me though, okay, right?
I can hear you and I can hear Sally Ann.
I'm not hearing you at all.
Okay, well, I can hear you, Sally Ann. Hey, Gregarious, let's pull her backstage and let's talk to her in private chat. It's probably just a quick setting.
It's a good thing she has a long bio. So
it actually is a long bio.
Yeah.
But I'll only read the first couple of portions of it. And worst case is that I have plenty of questions for you too, John. So Sally Ann is one of the 4% of women globally who has a patent pending method, an algorithm for measuring soft skills. So I'm hoping we can sort out her sound, because this is a perfect continuation to the conversation that we were just having with GERD. So Sally holds degrees and certifications, law, organizational behavior, and urban planning. I think she speaks 5 languages. She's a published author. Her education has spanned the globe, from Harvard, Franklin College, University of Toronto. And now she spends her time obsessing about Gleek, which is her technology company, which measures and develops soft skills, closes the soft skill gaps for any job, current and future, in what is reported to be 10 minutes a day. Gregarious, how are we looking on that sound? Is it working out?
I think his mic is off.
Oh, okay. Actually, it looks like she's just going to rejoin. So yeah.
Well, you know, I can jump in and vamp a little bit while we wait, which is one of the reasons why her work is so intriguing to me, and why Phil, our you know, friend and guy behind the curtain, suggested that we pull her in, is that the future of education, I think, is going to be much more distributed and deinstitutionalized. You know, you have now all of this work that's going on in credentialing, right? So immutable, non-tamperable, tamper-proof credentials that not only are your school transcript, which, you know, your school kind of controls, but, you know, acknowledges many different kinds of accomplishment and formative assessments and internships and projects and so forth and so on. And then on the other hand, you've got this vast ocean of demand for people with specific kinds of proficiencies. And in the middle, you're starting to see thinking, and also this is where Sally Ann comes in, platform strategies for linking the supply side and the demand side of talent. And that has many ramifications. So she seems to me to be right in the middle of a profound revolution in how education is going to be working.
In fact, so I can see that she's still working on the audio behind the scenes. Sally Ann, can you hear us? No, not yet. All right. Nope. So, oh, we can hear you though.
Yeah, we hear you. It's
maybe we should type the questions in. I wish I could. We can hear you, Sally Ann, but she can't hear us. let's see. I wish I could type faster.
You know, we could ask her to you know, speak a little bit about GLIAC. If you can hear her, or we can kind of do our own you know, improvisation on education and learning.
Actually, so John, do me a favor.
Let's go for it. Let's type. Let your audience witness
what it's like
when technology does not happen, and we are going to use our soft skills, and we're going to make it happen, and make this like one for the books.
Anybody?
So I'm reading, and let's answer. Let's go for it.
Okay, John, cover us for 30 seconds.
Okay, I'm going to do that. So imagine, I mean, my favorite kind of imaginary use case is a kid somewhere in an obscure geography who is very talented.
I'm waiting for you.
And who basically in the old world would have no access to big time opportunities, but maybe he finds or she finds a little quiz, and then the quiz leads to wanting to learn something, all of which can be accessed on their semi-smartphone. And then they progress and they do another assessment and another course. And then one day, out of the blue, they get a plane ticket, business class, to fly to London or New York and pursue a different kind of career. That's what the power of platforms is all about.
So let's talk about what's the difference between a hard skill and a soft skill. And hold on, we get to witness it live right now. You know, a hard skill, most of the times, you know, we think about it, let's say in a job context, we can measure it with degrees and tests and assessments. You know, think about, you know, the typical things if you're going for a job, whether it's in tech as a coder, there's a defined way we can look and see if you have that or not. A soft skill is that intangible thing. It's that thing, I want you to think about it, you know, John, or maybe Brian, when you think about each other, what is the thing that you, the most remarkable people you know, you walk out and there's something about them that absolutely, you can't put your finger on it, but you know when you see it, you feel it. Those are generally soft skills. It's what makes us uniquely human and not robots. Sadly, most of us forget that in our interactions with each other, that's the thing that makes us stand out. And why is that important, particularly now? So it's been important for me for a while now, but it seems like the whole world seems to be talking about it since COVID happened. And since we are all on technology, so I have to say to you that, you know, today is an example of how do you connect? How do you make people feel? How do you bring people together? How do you make people feel good? That's why it's so important now. We live in a world now where it really matters. Soft skills matters. What are businesses missing when it comes to soft skills? So businesses generally don't like things they can't measure and tie to a KPI or tie to a balance sheet. And soft skills has been in that fuzzy space for a really long time. But, you know, that's what I'm obsessed about. And that's what my algorithms, you know, I filed a patent on this about a year and a half ago. And I proudly share that because, and I share it from a place of making women aware. There's only 4% of women who've ever filed independently patents. And I share that because that number should be tenfold. But the patent and the algorithms, now we have machine learning. And what we can do with machine learning is just like, you know, everything is a pattern. If you have enough data, the patterns start showing up. And the same applies to soft skills. So your application of soft skills in situations, we can actually use, you know, as crazy as it sounds, machine learning to be able to show us quantitative, qualitative, and 360 feedback patterns to come up with a real measure. And algorithms are really great in terms of solving patterns because when we as humans judge each other, there's tons of bias in it. So it's a great way to solve in terms of soft skills, in terms of a measurement. How do we bridge the gap between employer demand and employee soft skill sets? So, you know, this is why I came up with something. It's like a FICO score. So think of a credit score. So soft skills needs, it's dynamic, right? We change and evolve. Our soft skills is like behaviors. It changes and evolves over time. So this particular way that I have people kind of jump into situations in a simulation base, I call it a micro practice. And I get to see how you apply it and get to see how other people apply it. It allows the gap, a language now to happen between an employer and a person. It allows them to signal. And it's the connectivity. It allows an employer to look and go, ah, I really think Brian over there is very good at innovation and creativity. And wait a minute, John, his critical thinking, along with his, like, you know, judgment and decision making, you know, they kind of work really well together. And it allows to see your quality of thought in the application of it. So that's what I'm obsessed about and what I'm working on. John is asking a question here. How do we balance education degrees with soft skills and jobs of the future? Oh my goodness. Like, you know, so education degrees as we know it right now are like dinosaurs. Do you know who invented a resume? Leonardo da Vinci, guys. It belongs on a wall, just like, you know, the paintings. And what is in a resume? It's traditional degrees, traditional work experience. They are the worst predictors of performance. You know, think about any situation you go into. You have to have a different set of soft skills. So what educators really need to be focused on, and they haven't for a long time, and, you know, rightfully so, right? The biggest stakeholders, parents, as long as schools are making money the way what they're doing, they're not going to change. So COVID has been the best thing that has happened to education, because what it's done is it backed everybody up against a wall. And now everyone has to focus on how do I translate skills, because those degrees have zero street value anymore, most of them anyway. You're lucky by the time you graduate if what you learn, you can even do something with it. And you're forced to now look at shortened degrees, micro-credentialing. Soft skills is 85% of job success, guys. And the more we get automated, the more, you know, I'm predicting, you know, very shortly, 3 or 5 years from now, we're going to have to, jobs and projects will need to find humans. And what are they going to find humans on what data set? It's not going to be the resume. It's going to be our quality of thought, the way that we act in situations. So that's the data set I'm building on. Okay. Let me see, Sally, does HR need to do differently moving forward from this point on? How do you further promote these benefits to companies? Absolutely. So HR, I mean, there's been a big shift. It's gone from functional, to way more human. But I think where HR is missing the boat is you need to understand, you know, every organization has top tail and bottom tail behaviors, and about 80% of the people fall in between. You have to figure out what those behaviors are, and there are tools to do that, to figure out what are the soft skills and what are the behaviors driving your organization. And then you know, not that you want to have the same thing throughout, because you're never going to have innovation. You want to be able to have different things, but you need to know, it's call a holacracy method, where what kind of skills and behaviors do I need to come together to be able to get certain types of outcomes or work on certain types of projects. And I think HR needs to get to that place, and people in HR are not going to be the traditional HR path. I think you need range in that role. You need diverse thinkers, because it's a very unpredictable world we're in right now, and you really need to understand the dynamics of people. Mm-hmm. What are the questions are you not being asked? And that's my cue to say goodbye. So what am I not being asked? I'm not being asked about all of this stuff happening right now on digital credentials. I'm not being asked about are job boards going to disappear soon? And my answer, I'll say quickly to both of those, credentials and digital credentials and wallets and blockchains and all of those things we're talking about make absolutely no sense. They're very efficient of managing traditional credentials, but I think the entire way that we signal and show up in the world needs to change, and it's not addressing that issue, particularly our soft skills. And second part I'm going to say is job boards, they have to watch out. You know, they're kind of dinosaur in the way they showcase us humans. They don't show the bigness, the length and breadth and depth of who we are. And on that note, I say thank you for having me, John and Brian. I can't believe I can't hear you, and this would be a first.
Wow, that was
thank
that
you,
was
John. Good. I like you.
You too. I like you too. That's imagine amazing. What it's gonna be like when we can actually hear each other and go back and forth. I mean, we've got to do a part two for sure.
Absolutely.
To the interact. I mean, there was so much to unpack there. I found it very exciting.
You know, I just realized that my whole system here, I froze on asking her a million questions. There's so many more questions to go with here. But hey, look, there's an amazing person backstage, actually, and a very, very dear friend that the last time I saw her was pre-COVID on a rooftop in downtown Los Angeles, probably the highest rooftop I've been on, well, aside from Singapore. But let's welcome Dr. Julie Albright. Dr. Julie, welcome to the show. How are you today?
Hey, how are you? It's so great to see you.
Hi, yes. Nice to meet you.
You were so high last time I saw you. I couldn't believe it.
Well, yes. Is that what you're literally talking about? Literally and figuratively, but that we can talk about champagne another time.
That was amazing. I know. Doesn't life seem like a dream now when you think back on those moments? It doesn't even seem real sometimes, I think.
Not that we have to jump into this, but you're on the front lines of social unrest, and I think you're going through yet another wave of it, and so you get to witness firsthand all of the things that we see on the news. Dr. Julie, for those who don't know, is in downtown Los Angeles, and has been central to a lot of the protests that we've been seeing and a lot of the Black Lives Matter movement. On that note, I mean, Dr. Julie, your book, your work, you're a digital sociologist, you're a professor, award-winning professor, you're a keynote speaker. I understand that you're working on your next book, but we do want to talk to you about your current book, Left to Their Own Devices. So with that, why don't we just jump right in and Dr. Julie, one of the things that both you and I share is the study of technology's relationship on humanity, society, behaviors, values, beliefs, and how this plays out now and over the future. And if it's one thing that I know you've observed was the growing gap between what societal institutions are teaching and reinforcing versus how, let's just say, millennials and below are wanting to live their life and also where they aspire to be. So maybe you can share with us some of your background, some of your work and inspiration, and then we'll jump into some of your observations.
Yeah, well, you're certainly my inspiration. Thank you so much for having me. And John, so nice to meet you and see you. And, you know, I've got to write another book to try to catch up with you. You're so productive. it's really super inspiring. So thank you guys for having me today. Yeah, my career, I'm a digital sociologist, as you said, and I've looked at the intersection of behavior and technology. I like to think about it like the strands of DNA. I'm sure people have seen that double helix of DNA, where behavior shapes technology and technology shapes behavior. And so I've sort of thought about it that way, where technology is driving behavior, and then behavior is also reshaping technology. So I started looking at that early on. I also have a master's and PhD. I have a dual doctorate in counseling. So I started noticing that people were meeting and mating online. And I showed it to my dad early on, those chat rooms. You remember where the words would scroll up? And I said, Dad, this is going to be huge. And my dad looked at that and said, why wouldn't anybody ever want to do that? but I knew it was going to be gigantic. So I went to USC to finish the next stage of my education. And there was an older gentleman there who happened to study 15th century Basel missions. And he was giving the welcome address to the new students saying, hey, we're all about new ideas. You have a new idea. Come on, talk to us. Can't wait to hear it. I thought, this is great. And I ran up there so excited. I said, I want to study the impact of computing on society. The guy looked at me and said, what does that have to do with sociology? I said, oh my gosh. Wow. I was in the Fred Flintstone School of Sociology and I didn't know it. So, you know, it took a number of years and it was a difficult journey. You know, what I found is that when you're in the white space between fields, or you're way on the leading edge of a field where people haven't really ventured yet, it's very difficult to be that sort of trailblazing pioneer in a new area. But of course, as you know, what's happened since, right? Walk out on any street, I dare you, around the world, and you're going to see that head bent over. It's almost like you could have a sign with a silhouette of the head bent over, and you would pick up that was someone on their cell phone connected to the internet. So it's really arguably one of the biggest drivers now of social change. And as you said, from what I call untethering or unhooking from traditional institutions, things like getting married, buying a home, having children, staying at a career for 30 years, going to church or joining a political party. Young people are simply not doing things at anywhere near the numbers of their, let's say, parents or grandparents or prior generations. So that's this overarching idea that I'm exploring in my book called Coming Untethered. And I have a whole chapter on the untethered workforce and how that's changing. And it's really been almost breathtaking to see how it's accelerated now under COVID.
I'm sorry, you were saying something? I have a quick question, John, and then I'll throw it over to you. And that is, Dr. Julie, what have you seen COVID sort of change since you've written the book. And I'll preface that with some context of showing that society at large has been thrust cross-generationally into living a digital first world, just simply because of shelter in place, lockdowns, quarantines. So how do you see, or are you thinking about how this cross-generationally is going to affect society moving forward? And then I'm going to add just a curveball in there. When you have people thrust into a new world without literacy, you start to see the rise of things like QAnon and how easy it is to believe misinformation online. So I guess there's the plus and the minus of this. So I'd love to hear your thoughts about where we're headed now that it's not just millennials becoming connected and digital first.
Yeah. Well, I think that that's really been the interesting thing. I've spent my career, as I said, looking at this intersection and wrote this book to really pull together the findings from disparate fields, from medicine to neuropsychiatry, to education and child development, health studies, psychology and sociology, et cetera, and brought it together. And what I was looking at was sort of the leading edge. You could kind of say the hipster millennial trends. You know, these are young, what we call digital natives, those that grew up in a world where there always was an internet. And what's happened now with COVID is, as you said, we've all been suddenly thrust into this untethered world, this untethered working, and where we have to have that digital screen in between us to do business, for education, even for socializing now because of COVID. So the trends that I explored in the book that were sort of leading edge trends again are now things that are impacting all of us across generations. And that really changes everything. And, you know, I have a chapter on the untethered workforce, for example, and that was that young people, because that you can work from your laptop at Starbucks, let's say, one of the studies that looked at that found that 7 out of 10 millennials, so these are college students and then young career professionals, feel not only they have the ability, but they have the right to work remotely. And that's a big shift. And so this idea that, well, why can't I just work from home? Why can't and want to demand this sort of flexible work or work from home idea? Well, now everyone's doing it. And what the difference now is, because of COVID, some companies like the Twitters and Coinbase and others are saying, you know what? Why do we need these expensive offices in San Francisco and other cities? Let's just do away with that. And we're all going to work untethered. We're all going to work from home or from wherever you want. So this whole thing is accelerating. And another trend linked to that that I explored is this idea of sort of hashtag van life. If you look at Instagram, you go on YouTube, you're going to see these tricked out like Mercedes Sprinters vans or RVs and things like that, where young people traditionally, they've been fixing these up and saying, hey, if I can then work from anywhere, why don't I work from the beach? Or, hey, let me go snowboard today and then I'll work from my van later, and et cetera, being all over the place. At life is one big adventure kind of thing. So that's what's happened now, is this whole thing is not only during COVID moment, but what I'm going to suggest is that these changes that we're seeing of living untethered, working untethered, driven by, first of all, our technological environment, now with the COVID environment, these trends you're going to see accelerating and moving beyond COVID now. So we're going to have to readjust to this untethered world in the workplace, in education, and in our social life in a way that I don't think we could have imagined even a couple of years ago, possibly even last year.
Yeah, yeah. And John, you take the next question, but I want to just preface it by whatever you answer to John's question, address, or maybe we could address it later, the literacy part, because I do see in parts of the United States and
oh, yeah, sure,
Australia and the UK where this is becoming a huge new gap.
It's a key. Do you want me to address that now, or do you want?
Why not? Yeah, go ahead.
Please, Dr.
Yeah, Lee. Sorry. That was a very complex question. There was a lot to unpack there. I only unpacked the carry-on bag, and now I have to.
Well, for those who want to see, here's the whole question. Scroll.
Yeah, I know. The question was about, so forgive me, audience, the question was about 8 paragraphs long, and I got to paragraph 5, and then I ran out of steam. So I actually wrote a whole chapter on this in my book. It's called Synchronization and Harmonization. And what I'm looking at, I've taught for years at USC social psychology. I told you I have a background in counseling and psychology and all this. And so when I started seeing some of the things that were happening, I got very concerned because I know how powerful social influence is, how we can shape the behavior of others in groups. And there's a lot of known research on that. And what was happening was bad actors, let's call them, that wanted to reshape elections or other sorts of things are using these tried and true, tested, known ideas around how people behave at scale and sort of automating, if you will, this social pressure to behave, to respond in a certain way. And, you know, you can walk in and have someone interact with a group of people and reshape how they behave. You want to look at YouTube, the Ash conformity study. There's a little video on that kind of thing and watch what happens. You're going to be stunned. And what's happened now is you can create bots. You can create sort of fake people to propagate on a scale and target, hyper-target people based on their interests and their fears. And one of the companies that we've known now about, Cambridge Analytica, did that by using something called the Big Five on a group of people. And what that does is it analyzes your personality. And one of the qualities of that is called neuroticism. How kind of neurotic or nervous or anxious are you? And they can create an audience around those that are most anxious and bang, hit them with something. Like, for example, if you're afraid that your guns are going to be taken away, we can hyper target just that issue. And then you say, I knew it, because there's something about confirmation bias where you want to confirm your ideas and you're looking for information to confirm. So they're using all these psychological and social psychological, the pressure of the group, let's say, the pressure of the crowd, to shape behavior and move people in a way that they want them to move. And it's very diabolical. It's you can't necessarily tell that you're being pressured in that way or that the person isn't even real. As we get AI getting more sophisticated, there won't be a way to be literate. That's the danger of this thing. I had a discussion on the stage in Monaco. This was a summer ago with Dean Nelson, who ran Uber and PayPal, eBay, their digital networks, and the lead engineer for Apple. And I said, we're going to need to have trust is the issue. Where is this information coming from? So we need markers of provenance. Where is this coming from? And markers of, you know, trust, if you will, or reliability of information. Because if you've got this fake information, at least people say, well, you know, and some platforms are starting to do that. But it's against their business model to have people peeling off of the platform. So, you know, if you get people riled up and keep them riled up, you know, they keep engaging. So it's a very difficult situation that we find ourselves in now. And I think that the answer cannot be simply do your homework, because it's going to get increasingly hard to do.
Yeah. John, over to you.
Yeah. So we share a clinical background, among other things. And there's a theme of all three guests today, which is about the balance between the technological and the humanistic, or the the personal, right, let's say, for want of a better word. Mm. And so if empathy is a hallmark of being human, and empathy is what we respond to in other people, as was said before earlier today, and empathy is what allows us to appreciate great music, it kind of is a hallmark, in a way, of being human as we understand it up until now. What happens to that whole notion of empathy and emotional connection and, you know, kind of emotional acuity when so much of contemporary experience is focused around digital devices and kind of mediated communication? I mean, what are you seeing in terms of the trends? Are we getting a generation of humans who are still empathetic, but in a different way? Or is that kind of basic, you know, kind of interpersonal hit of I'm with you and I empathize and I kind of take in your experience as being as legitimate as mine? Does that kind of change?
I think that's a wonderful question. It's a very sophisticated question. And the idea is, I think, and I've looked at that originally in my dissertation work, in fact, and the idea is that when you're in a mediated environment, you don't have physical co-presence. Like, we're not sitting together in a room. And the internet allows a measure of, let's call it, perceived anonymity. The idea that you're kind of got a little cloak of anonymity around you. And you can see that, for example, in the comments. You know, I've been looking at TikTok lately as that sort of an emerging platform. And the things people say are just absolutely brutal. You know, a kid recently had committed suicide, for example, and people are just saying, oh, good. You know, the cruelest comments that you could imagine. In other words, displaying a lack of empathy because they're not in the same room. They're not, it's things that they would never say face to face. We've evolved certain social graces, certain social norms about how we interact with one another that have evolved over time because we are social beings. We need to be, right? If we couldn't operate in a group, the species would die out. So we've developed these ways of understanding, of empathy, as you said. Empathy is one of the qualities of, I would suggest, emotional health, mm-hmm. emotional wellness, emotional intelligence. These are the kind of qualities that also are key in success. If you can empathize with a client, for example, oh, okay, I see what I need to help you with in this situation. That's calling on empathy to do so. And, yeah, we have a generation growing up now that the majority of their communication is mediated. A new study found that, for example, teens are more likely to talk to their best friend through the device than face-to-face or on a phone call. So lacking the body language, which is the majority of our communication in many instances, we're going to see a lowering of empathy. And certainly we see that displayed online. So, yeah, that's a real issue. And it's really driving, I think, some of the mental health issues that we're seeing amongst young people today.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack in there. And I'm glad we put that question on the table. The other question I'm really eager to ask you about is how your research and your knowledge and this notion of somehow a growing distance between let's say young users of technology and traditional institutions, which is a very current question, is what happens to democracy and representative democratic processes and, you know, kind of connection to traditional institutions and even to the idea of democracy and the American mm-hmm. idea and all of that kind mm-hmm. of stuff when you've got all of this technology that's kind of changing that quality of connection.
That's another, you guys ask wonderful questions, but these are very sophisticated questions. Each one of these could be a whole hour in itself, I'm sure, but I won't take an hour to answer it. What I would say, though, is that, again, the studies are showing an interesting shift in perception where young people, millennials, for example, that grew up in this digital environment are more likely to consider themselves citizens of the world. That the nation state doesn't matter. It's more like, it doesn't matter to me. It's more hyper-local, my neighborhood, or global. So this idea that the nation state doesn't matter as much, it doesn't impact me. We see that in the voter turnout, you know, young people not coming out to vote, even then people are trying to drive them out there. It's because of the shifting perception, I think. And part of that is, you've got the Instagram, for example, showing these fabulous lives, you know, backpacking through Europe or living on an island or poolside in Bali kind of thing. So there's this imagination that you can just be anywhere. And millennials are more likely to have a passport and to make that happen in a sense. Unhooking from getting married and having a 30-year mortgage and kids in a school cuts you loose to go do all these sort of adventurous things in a way. So I think that is a very meaningful question of the moment. And it's something that I think people don't really take into consideration, these generational shifts in perception about how nation state democracy relate to me, the I generation, as opposed to we're all in this together. You know, we're not all in this together now. We're all in our filter bubbles on our device separated together.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've been in this social context for 270 some years, and it's worked really well, and it's commanded the loyalty of countless generations of people who've sacrificed immensely. And so one would hope somehow that there'd be an adaptation that of the let's say, call it the ideology, for want of a better word, and the institutions to the cognitive patterns and technology uses of young people. Because otherwise, we're going to mutate as a society into something that's right. rather unrecognizable compared to where we were before. And, yeah. and, you know, we may be giving up a lot in doing that.
Well, you know, I work, as Brian announced in the top of the show, I work at the University of Southern California, and we're already seeing some of that mutation, to be honest with you. I did a talk at the book fair there, the LA Times Festival of Books, with our wonderful Dean of Religious Life, Varun Soni. He's a real rock star. And he told a story where a kid came up to him and said, "Hey, Dean Soni, can we set aside one table so we could talk in the new dining hall?" He said, "What are you talking about?" Kid said, "Have you been in the new dining hall?" He goes, "No." He goes, "Well, go in and check it out." He goes, "Every kid is sitting by himself at or herself at their own table, looking at a device, and no one's talking to each other."
Wow.
and he was like, "Oh my God." And then he was like, "Well, of course you can have a table." And then he said to everybody, like thinking out loud, "Well, wait a minute. Now, if I set aside one table for no devices where you talk, am I saying that the rest of the 90% of the tables, it's fine not to talk to each other?" Like, he was suddenly thrown into this, you know, reshaping moment, as you're hinting at there, where we're seeing that in terms of the social interactions, particularly the face-to-face, the voice-to-voice on the phone. Some of those skills are waning, and that's going to have some big implications.
Mm. Yeah, I'm going to just throw one thing out there real quick. As an observation, Dr. Julian, I think you could appreciate this, is one of the things that I'm seeing moving forward is this notion of, I used to call people who are just screen dependent and socially awkward now as a result of that, digital introverts. But one of the things that I'm seeing now in 2020 is emboldenment to shift from digital introvert to physical extrovert, and starting to see that anonymity that you were speaking about is really starting to shift from the digital screen into the real world, where people are just taking that confidence or that yes. mistaken superpower into the real world and starting to become that asshole in real life. So I just one last thing before we sign off is, you know, what advice do you have for us to kind of contend with this, especially as we move toward an election?
Yeah. Well, it's a huge challenge. And the problem is, as you know, these devices are, I never used the word, by the way, when we first started looking at this stuff, addictive. I didn't like that word. I thought, oh, people watch TV, who cares? You know, now they're watching a different kind of screen. But since that point, and with the advent of mobility, where the phone goes with you anywhere, the internet goes with you anywhere, the apps like the Instagrams, et cetera, TikToks, they're designed to be addictive. They're designed to keep you coming back for more. The texting apps, the notifications, they know that. There's studies on this. And it's just like the Vegas slot machine. You keep coming back for more. And we know gambling's addictive. Same process. So the problem is, you know, I'm not trying to be Amish, I always say. You know, I'm not saying throw out devices. But we do need to create some sacred spaces where we step aside, step away from the device. Family dinners, good start. Go out for a hike or a walk, spend time in nature. We need to reconnect with our bodies and ourselves. We need to connect with nature, something bigger than ourselves, to get away from our problems and worries. And we need to connect with each other without having a device distracting us and not really deeply connecting, because there comes that lack of empathy and everything else that you talked about.
Well, thank you, Dr. Julie. It's a perfect way to end. Her book, Left to Your Own Devices, you can follow her on social media. She is someone incredible to learn from and just also a good friend. I look forward to toasting you in the real world.
I can't wait. You guys are wonderful. Thank you so much for having me.
Fantastic. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. And John, that concludes yet wow. another episode of Intersections. Did it fly by or what?
Yeah, we're having fun.
Yeah, man, I really enjoy these conversations. I am man, I am charged up after these conversations, and I really want to see if we can revisit somehow the conversation about hard skills, soft skills, getting back to creativity. So maybe we can dedicate an episode to that coming up as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. So many ways of curating the ideas that come out of here and growing them. And I'm excited about all of the downstream embodiments of intersections, because I think that'll really help to enrich the knowledge.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you're watching, if you have recommendations for guests, ideas for topics, if you want to help out with the show, just reach out. Also, I want to remind you that we do have a newsletter that we're going to be starting soon. Please subscribe. Gregarious, thank you for being on top of that super fast. You could follow at John Kao on Twitter, and he's on LinkedIn and Facebook, and I'm at Brian Solis and all of the above as well. So with that, thank you for joining us. John, send us out.